Welcome back. My name's Sarah, and in this unit, we've been talking about who we are. We've talked about how we are perfectly... and we are fully... and today, we're going to talk about our eternal mission and purpose. A few weeks ago, we talked about how we are made in the... of God. In the image of God. When God made people, He gave them a mission, a purpose, to rule the earth with Him. He created a good world, and He's invited humans to keep making the world even more awesome by creating along with Him. What are some examples of how people make the world more awesome? We create art and beauty, and we farm to make more food so that more people can be fed, and we build amazing things. And we've also talked about how sin, our selfishness, has made the world not totally awesome anymore. And Jesus told His followers that because of Him, because of Jesus, the kingdom of God had come near. And He called His followers to build His kingdom. What does that mean? It means to make the world more awesome, to counteract the destruction of sin and selfishness in the world, to do things like invent vaccines and new ways to farm, to help people who are starving, to take care of the poor and the lonely, to be kind, to be a friend to a person that has no one, to love others. Your purpose is not to be happy, to have a good life, to have as much fun as you can while you're alive. It's to make this world more like God's kingdom, like God is in charge, and to invite more people into His kingdom. Remember a few weeks ago we talked about human love and God's love? What are some of the ways that God's love is like human love? 2 weeks ago we talked about some of these things. Human love can reflect and show us God's love. What are some ways God's love is different than human love? We are fully loved by God. He already loves us the maximum possible amount. So nothing we can do can get God to love us more, and nothing we can do can get God to love us less. People can't love like that. People, like your parents, can really, 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 really love you, but there's always part of human love that is selfish, that's insecure, that makes us try to take what we want and need from people we're trying to love, that gets hurt when we don't get it. We can make the world more like God's kingdom by loving others, but we'll always let people down with our love and be let down by other people's love. If that's how we're trying to feel good about ourselves, to feel okay about who we are, it's only by knowing and living in God's love for us that we can be fulfilled here on earth, only by becoming part of His kingdom. 1 John 4:10 says, "Here is what love is. It's not that we loved God. It is that He loved us and sent His Son to give His life to pay for our sins." Not only is God's love the only hope we and our friends have of being fully loved here on earth, but only by Jesus paying for our sins can we continue to live in His love forever, now and after we die. How did Jesus do that? Jesus paid for our sins. He atoned for them, if you remember what we learned in the big story of the Bible. He atoned for them by dying on the cross for us. That's how much He loves you. And the good news is so good because you are fully loved, and so is every person. No matter who you are or who they are, what you've done or what they've done, Jesus gave His life to pay for our sins. Romans chapter 10 says this: "There's no difference between those who are Jews and not. The same Lord is the Lord of all, and He richly blesses everyone who calls on Him." Scripture says, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Who will be saved? Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord. Does that mean everyone will be saved? No. God fully loves everyone, and Jesus died on the cross and has forgiven everyone, but we have to receive that forgiveness. He doesn't force it on us. Let's read that again and we'll keep going. Scripture says, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How can they call on him unless they believe in him? And how can they believe in him unless they hear about him? And how can they hear about him unless someone preaches to them? And how can anyone preach without being sent? It is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. What has to happen for someone to be able to believe in Jesus and be forgiven? They have to hear about him. You all have friends at school that have not heard the good news about Jesus. Some may not know who Jesus is. Some do, but they don't know or understand who he really is, the Son of God. Some might believe that kind of, but they don't have a mom or dad or church who's teaching them more and more about who he is or what it means to follow him. I want you to think of that person or those people now. Who is going to tell them the good news that they are perfectly designed by God and fully loved by God? You are. There are people in your life right now that only you can tell the good news to. There are people who, if you don't tell them that God loves them and invite him to be part of his kingdom, no one will. The man who wrote Romans, that's what we just read, was named Paul. Does anyone know who he was or anything about him?
The miracle of mercy. Paul. This is Saul. Saul was a Pharisee who hated the followers of Jesus so much that he would hunt them down to be brought to trial in Jerusalem. And he would even seek to murder them. Saul was uttering threats with every breath, and he was eager to kill the Lord's followers. So he went to the high priest. He asked him to write a letter to the Jews in Damascus that would allow him to arrest any Christians he found there. He wanted to bring them, both men and women, back to Jerusalem in chains. Now Saul went on his way, and as he came near Damascus, a light from heaven flashed around him, and he heard a voice that said, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" Saul cried out, "Who are you, Lord?" And the voice said, "I am Jesus. Rise and go into the city, and you will be told what to do." So Saul got up and he opened his eyes, but he couldn't see anything. So the men who were with Saul led him into the city. After 3 days, a man named Ananias came to Saul. He put his hands on Saul, and immediately Saul could see again. And with that, Saul became a follower of Jesus. He became the very thing he had tried to hunt. And he immediately began telling people that Jesus is the Son of God. And he taught them about the mercy of God that he had received. And all who heard him were amazed. He then went by a new name, Paul, as he began preaching not just to the Jewish people, but to everyone. Despite many difficulties like being imprisoned, shipwrecked, and narrowly escaping death multiple times, Paul continued to preach about Jesus. Paul said that he would do everything he could to save people and help them know God. And that's just what he did in order to reach people who would otherwise be unreached. And many came to know Jesus because of what Paul said. Paul taught many in his day through his letters, but even more have come to learn more about Jesus through the letters of Paul that can be read even to this day.
Once Paul knew Jesus really did rise from the dead and he really was God, what did he do? He started telling everyone. Was that always easy for Paul? No. Sometimes he was in prison, he was hungry, he was shipwrecked, he was beat up by people. It was really hard. Why do you think he kept doing it? He never stopped because he believed that scripture says, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And how can they call on him unless they've believed in him? And how can they believe in him unless they hear about him? And how can they hear about him unless someone preaches to them? He knew it was his job to tell people the good news. Paul knew how much Jesus had loved him and had forgiven him. And that the most loving thing he could do for other people was to share that news with them too. He also taught in his letters how followers of Jesus can make this world more like God's kingdom now by how we treat and take care of each other and how we live in the world. Have you ever told someone about Jesus? How did that go? How did you feel before and after? What happened? Leaders, you can share first. There are people in your life right now that only you can tell the good news to. There are people who, if you don't tell them that God loves them, no one will. Who are those people? Take some time to write down their names now. You have an eternal purpose. What's the word eternal mean? That it lasts forever and ever and ever and ever. Your purpose is an eternal purpose because when we share the good news that Jesus loves us, people can call on him and be saved, be forgiven and given eternal life, be part of his kingdom forever and ever. Maybe one day in the new heaven and earth, you'll be sitting with someone and you'll find out that something you said or did helped them know about Jesus and or start to trust him or know that he loved them. And that was part of the reason why they are now getting to live forever with Jesus in you. Isn't that amazing? The things you do now could have an impact on people forever and ever. I know many stories of kids your age who have led their friends and even their parents to start following Jesus. Paul also wrote this in his letter to the church in a city called Ephesus, Ephesians chapter 2. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it's a gift from God. Not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Jesus Christ to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. You are God's handiwork, perfectly designed by him. You were created on purpose for a purpose. To do good works that he planned ahead of time for you to do. Ways only you can reflect God's image to your friends. Ways and places only you can make the world more like his kingdom. But these good things aren't what save you or get God to love you. It's a gift. He just loves you because he loves you. We have work and a mission to do. But our identity, who we are, doesn't come from how well we live out that mission, but by the free gift of God's love and grace that we never have to and never can earn. You're probably not going to be a famous artist, not a famous singer or an athlete or an artist. Nobody other than a few friends and family on earth will probably ever know who you are. You're probably not going to invent a new thing or start a company that will make everyone know your name. But the God who created the universe, He knows your name, and He has a purpose for your life. In some ways, it's kind of like a secret mission, because to most people, it doesn't look like a big deal. It looks like you're going to school every day and being loving to your friends. And when you grow up, it looks like making the world more like His kingdom by doing your job and being part of your family, by doing loving things for others, and by actually telling them that God loves them, telling them how they are perfectly designed and fully loved. That's your secret mission. It looks pretty ordinary, but it has an eternal purpose and impact. Why you ever chose me? We are going to take some time now to pray for the people in our lives that God has given us to share His love with. Right now, I want you to think about one person. Write their name down. Now think about what you like about them, how they are designed by God. Write that down. And tomorrow you can find a way to tell them that. Think about a way to show them love. Write that down. This week, you can do that. And pray that they will choose to become part of God's kingdom. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see. Nobody but Jesus.